Bobby said, Katigorio. Sass, no teach me nonsense.
Oh my God.
You are serving us.
Well, see, I carry iPhone, me say we know the same level. So,
you be our boy, if you carry iPhone.
Welcome to me, Shakara, beg.
If I dress like this for street of Lagos, Sass will arrest me.
No, you can actually wear this one to the bank and work in the office every day.
They are going
to
call me Yahoo boy.
Well, good for them because they don't know what they are doing.
They didn't even know what Yahoo means because some of them didn't even have an email. Right?
Maybe they didn't use Yahoo messenger.
Okay.
So, welcome ladies and gentlemen to today's program. We are really excited to have you on board. We want to use this opportunity to say a very big thank you to the Nigerian youth and every single individual that came out here for yesterday's protest and even early today as regards to the End SARS campaign. A very, very big thank you. I've never really seen a moment where, you know, I'm so proud of the Nigerian youth back home and abroad for taking the intervention and bold step and, you know, really marching head to head with the government and see, you know, going by the situation in the country. Today, my co-presenter is here. My name is Darwin John Adeni, and here's my
name is Victor Olaore Omoshen, as usual. So, want to say a very big thank you to all Nigerian young people who came out to the street for almost a week, who have been protesting, and with all the viral tweets and message on social media, all the people that have been using their platform at various levels to advocate, including the social movement activists, NGOs, media houses that are also supporting the young people to call for the end of SARS. Congratulations to all of us because we have actually won the war. Like, no more SARS, they've been dissolved, and we want to thank P-Square for the very big job he's been doing using this platform to reach out to people and encouraging young people to advocate, including Omo Beta, who have actually been marching. We've seen him leading protests on the streets with a lot of young people saying no to SARS, saying no to their police brutality, their arbitrary arrest, and all of those violations of our fundamental human rights as Nigerian citizens.
Omo Beta actually did like a 2 hours long march. I actually watched it on YouTube. It was on the street of Sunlere.
He can actually do more than that. It's strong.
You know, our area. So we also want to say a very big thank you to Files. I think his name is Fala now, please. I apologize.
Yes, you're right.
We want to say a very big thank you to Fars for his support, for his contribution, for his voice. Fars is never tired. You know, you see him under the bridge, you know, with the people taking action to end police brutality, and also Naira Marley. Everybody's voice counts. This is when, you know, we need to realize that every single individual, if you can make any little influence, and we are campaigning for a solution as youth population, we always need your voice.
For me, I think I really also want to appreciate Burna Boy and Wizkid with the current protests they are leading in London. And of course, Burna Boy have been using this platform as well to reach out to young people in the country and, you know, advocate against the brutality of the police and the SARS operation in the country.
So, a very big thank you to Tiwo Savage, because we need the voice of women. And we actually did get a couple of them, which my colleague is going to say more about that later. We're thanking Tiwa Savage and
Feikemi
Aldo.
No matter, you don't choke. You don't choke, Boga. You don't forget how to pronounce that.
Forgive me for my
name. Now, I'm a Fulani.
No, leave me alone. Get out.
We say big shout outs to Tenny and Davido, who are also using their platform to reach out and also be on the streets, march with the people. I know there have been a lot of controversy with Davido's statement, tweet, and all of that, but I have to tell you something, that all the people that refuse to come out and join the protest, they are already regretting right now. I think we got a very powerful letter. Oh, there's Olamilekan.
Yeah, Lekan.
Lekan,
we're saying a big thank you to you.
The
we
big are brother like, winner.
We can be thousands of miles away and thousands of kilometers away, but we are really we're really grateful. We feel fulfilled, you know, with the support and intervention of everyone.
And you know, Leko composed a particular song. The song, yeah, he did a song on the NSAS, and it was really interesting. He did some rap. I mean, it was touching, so inspiring. I think Leko is using this platform well, and for me, I think that if young people in Nigeria can come out to, for over a week, we're able to advocate because we feel that it's all an issue that affects all of us. Even if you're being like
from whatever part of the country you are and all that, people standing against the water cannon that was fired at them today.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll dive more into that.
So I think the greater hero of all of these movements are the people that paid a larger price, like the people that were shot by the police during the protest, who died, lost their lives, and all of that. So we want to use this medium to give our condolence to the family,
to the parents,
yes, of those people that lost their lives.
Okay, we'll get more into that. So today we woke up to the news of some fraudulent practices and some price hack around the price of drugs for treatment of HIV and AIDS situation in Nigeria. As you may know, there was once a time that Nigeria was having the second largest HIV pandemic in the entire world. You know, China inclusive, London, Argentina, anywhere you can think of in the whole world, Nigeria actually once had second largest HIV epidemic, which necessitates the need for adequate programming. And many of us have experience in programming for people, working from the field, as outreach coordinator, as programs manager, head of program, executive directors. A lot of people have contributed their effort. You know, not just a case of people living with HIV. Every individual who felt concerned in the healthcare sector, social worker, we've been doing our best. But what is going on right now is really, really appalling. And then we felt like there is a need to actually dig down into the situation, and we're going to keep you informed.
Okay, so first I'm going to say that what we have currently is like an accusation.
Okay.
There is no evidence.
It's opinion based.
Yes, it's an opinion based. There's no evidence that there's a price hike. Mm-hmm. But what we have is that the network of people living with HIV, the national coordinator, and the national coordinator of civil society legislative organization, CISLAC, did a lot of press. They did press conference,
publicity.
And there's a lot of publicity in the media, like The Punch, The Vanguard, The Guardian. All of these media houses were accusing the National Agency for the Control of AIDS of doing a procurement violations and hiking the price of ART in the country, using a direct or using the contractors that are going to supply the ARV. And I feel that if you read all of the content, some of the publication in the newspaper, you see that the people who are accusing NACA, they didn't even understand the statistics around the HIV epidemic currently in the country.
We've been working on research and analyzing data as social workers. Like, we always face this Excel sheet that is always live every day.
Yes.
You know, sometimes I leave office so late. Some of our outreach workers have gone home. They'd be like, Darwin, why are you working so late? You know, there is a lot at stake. You know, that's why we've been committed. We've volunteered our time and energy to making things work. But like my colleague said, it's based on allegation. But one thing I'm going to say is this. Behind every mess, there's always a message. So it is the edge behind the mess that we need to look at.
Yeah, for me, I think it's part of the job of network of people with HIV as a patient network, including the civil society movement, if there's no any other motive behind their actions. But of course, they need to understand what the statistics is saying. You can't just call a press conference, you are telling us that there are 3.1 million people living with HIV, when actually the people living with HIV in the country currently is 1.9 million. So first, you are giving a misinformation to the media, and the media are buying it, they are eating it, because the media we have today, they are not ready to, I don't think they do their research to even ask questions about those data they are supplying.
That has been as old as anything. The media organization in Nigeria often, you know, do their publication, and sometimes it's questioning. You keep wondering, where do they get their source of data?
For me, I think if CISLAC, including NEPOAN, are part of the National AIDS Impact Indicator Survey, one thing they should understand is that according to the national the NAS survey that was concluded in 2000 and that was presented in 2019, a lot of things has happened. And some of the things that happened is that we now have an accurate data. accurate statistics that show the true picture of the people living with HIV in the country could stand at 1.9 million. If you go to the UNAIDS website, you are going to see the current data, the current statistics even on NACA website. So how do you go to a press media and then tell the press that there are 3 million people living with HIV when actually we have 1.9 million? So they are giving us a wrong indication. Even the prevalence rate.
Yeah.
The prevalence rate among age 15 to 40, 49 years old is currently standing at 1.5%. Okay. So, which is like one of the lowest that we've seen in age.
All right. I think all the data we're presenting right now are subject to verification, but let us give you a little bit background of history. You know, according to the World Health Organization. So, considering the HIV, the epidemic level and trends, you know, around the gender and data issues around HIV and AIDS, Nigeria, based on history, Nigeria has a severe, rapidly growing HIV epidemic characterized by adult prevalence in the range from 3.6% to 8.0%, depending on which state you are actually analyzing or looking into. According to the World Health Organization also, the website says the epidemic is generalized and driven primarily by heterosexual transmission since the first case was discovered in 1986. So adult prevalence as around 1991 was 1.8, and then it rose to 5.8 in 2001, and then further declined down to 5.0 from the 8%, you know, around 2003. So women are believed to be more at risk, you know, and more severely affected than men. So now, how did we fall into this situation of going from 1.8% to 5.8%, and how did we make some progress downward based on what we've done so far around programming? We need to let you know, because there's a lot of work going around.
For me, I think that in the country, we've actually achieved a lot of progress. There have been a drastic progress in the country since the HIV response started many years back in the country. And you can see that civil society organizations play a significant role in the development of this
epidemic,
of the progress that have been achieved. And of course, the government itself, within the little capacity and resource limitations that we have in the country, a lot of progress have been done. Before now, you know, we don't really have an association of people, because I just want to give like a summary of the picture of the current situation, I mean previous situation of HIV in the country. We don't really have a network of people living with HIV, because then nobody want to come out. The stigma was very high, discrimination was on the high cases, and of course, as at then, the Ministry of Health, the National Agency for the Control of AIDS, and the UNAIDS was able to support little platform. I think there were about 12 support groups in the country, and in 1998.
And then we have how many states? There was a lot of states.
Yeah, in 1998, these 12 support groups came together and they formed the network of persons living with HIV in the country. And remember, within that short period to year 2000, there's an organization in Lagos called JADE, Journalists Against AIDS. So what they did to combat and reduce the spread of HIV and stigma and discrimination, which was like a fuel driving the pandemic, was that they launched this Red Ribbon Award.
Red Ribbon, yeah.
Yeah, so the Red Ribbon Award, they were identifying heroes, champions.
Organizations that have made significant impact. I remember the Initiative for Equal Rights actually won the Red Ribbon Award.
So in year 2000, when they started Red Ribbon Award, they were actually identifying individual persons living with HIV, men and women, and they were giving an award to this individual to encourage people to come out and serve as a role model in society, and then help to impart the spread of
limits the spread of
HIV. Yes,
in but the I hope this whole stigma thing does not happen with COVID, because we don't even know where we are heading on with the issue of COVID-19 right now. We programmers, we are always concerned, you know, on public
health. Let me continue to go with some of the historic achievement that the country have achieved. You know, in 2003, before 2003, HIV treatment was very expensive. People have to pay a lot of money to get treated. Mm-hmm. And of course, then Nigerian government just rolled out a project, a particular program that was like 10,000 people to be placed on ART. So if you are not part of the people that are, that is going to be placed on this government program, you cannot get treatment without paying out of your pocket. And then Medicine Sans Frontières came into the country in 2003, and they started the first free comprehensive treatment in Lagos, yeah, for persons living with HIV. And then that particular facility in General Hospital Lagos Island had over 4,500 persons living with HIV who were enrolled on the care, not only receiving ART as a treatment, but comprehensive treatment, including access to viral load testing, counseling, support group, palliative care, therapeutic support, and including every other psychosocial support that you can give to an AIDS patient.
Yeah, but now imagine one hospital have over 4,000 patients.
Yes,
and then we have cap of 10,000 in the country.
Yes,
that actually gets me scared, because when I did my research, I found out that there was a particular period where people were taking almost 4 tablets, like 4 times a day.
Yes,
and then the medicine actually did progress to a point where people just have to take only one single tablet, like 2 times a day.
Yes,
and right now we're at the point whereby there have been significant progress by pharmaceutical organization, whereas people just only need to take a single tablet one time a day, and that's it.
I think that we've done a lot in the country, and both the government, the civil society organization, the patients community, everybody collectively have done a lot, because we could remember at the point when there was no enabling environment in terms of policy to protect the right and welfare of persons living with HIV.
On top of stigma and discrimination.
Yes, when individuals were rejected by companies, even if they are qualified to do the job, even if they pass through the screening and they are competent enough to do the job, the companies will reject them because they are HIV positive. But right now, since 2004, I think 2014, the former president of Nigeria, Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, in November 14, was able to pass the Anti-Discrimination and sign into law the Anti-Discrimination Act. So with that, it now protects the welfare and interest of persons living with HIV. Being HIV positive does not affect your intellectual ability to contribute to the society or even to work and pay your tax to the state and federal government of the country.
Just the same way having dreadlocks does not make you young.
Exactly! There you're talking!
But, you know, based on that, each state actually had to go further and pass their own law. Because I remember Kaduna State actually had to locally enact
the same anti-discrimination law.
Enugu did the same thing. I think Lagos State did the same thing, and several other selected states. I think within a year, we have about 8 states that did that. You know, while other states are also still in progress.
Yes, and I think that in 2004, you know, the UNFPA was able to support NACA to identify young people in the country who are contributing to the response. And then the NINETA network was formed. The National Youth Network on HIV and AIDS was formed in 2004 in Kano. I can remember then, after that, we were able to go ahead and form the Association of Women Living with HIV and AIDS in 2005, where women living with HIV were identified to also contribute their quota to the response. And in the same year, religious leaders living with HIV and AIDS were identified, and they were mobilized to also form their own platform where they can reach out to, because there was a lot of stigma and discrimination cases that were happening within the religious institution. Maintaining couples were denied marriage because one person is positive and the other one is negative, and then there's a lot of stigma happening even in the church or in the mosque. And then we also have the young people living with HIV, APIN, that was also identified and formed in the same 2005. So we cannot even overemphasize the role of the community at large.
The individuals, the
society, organization. Everybody have done so well, and now this is where we are.
Okay, so imagine a situation where, as a religious leader, let's say I happen to fall into the situation of living positive, and a big couple come to me, and because the church policy say I cannot join them together, whereas I already have a wife, like I could just imagine the kind of mental stress
suppression
and situation that people go through. And we don't have adequate mental health facility in the country. Now we are going to come back to the actual big dilemma that we wake up to see today, the current situation. And part of what fueled some of these social issues, because we are working mostly with old data and we need to update our system.
Yes, thank you Remy Omaki for coming online, and Ayinde Adeshina, we appreciate you for coming online. But of course, I think as a country, in the year 2000s, when we placed about 10,000 persons living with HIV on antiretroviral therapy, the country was able to move a bit forward. with a lot of advocacy effort that was coming from the pressure from civil society organization and the patient community. In 2005, I could remember late Professor Babatunde Oshiotumeyi, who was the former DG of NACA, was also able to work with the government of Nigeria to increase about placing a target of 250,000 people on ART. And then we also moved to 3x5. You heard about the 3x5, which is like 3 million people is going to be placed on treatment by 2005.
Okay.
We were not able to achieve...
But all this problem actually was part of what makes some of our local citizens develop their solution, like Dr. Abalaka, one of our famous person. The country could not deal with issues, and we have individuals, you know, coming up with their own regimen and be like, Omo, if the federal government cannot solve this problem, I can find something for you.
No, I think the Dr. Abalaka case is one of the one of the dynamo we have in, yeah, in the response.
Basically, but it's as a result of not being able to cover a lot
in the 2000s, when Dr. Abalaka came up with this claim about HIV cure he had, of course, the universal standard or procedure is that you need to subject some of this evidence that you have to clinical trials.
When you have big pharma that is going to come and steal it.
No, nobody's coming to steal. This is about life. You can't just cook up a concussion somewhere without... No. This is human that is going... Remember, Dr. Abalaka is a veterinary doctor. A veterinary doctor that eats their patients. Like a doctor that takes... Yeah. So you can't be a vet doctor. You are coming up with concussions. You want to give to patients. And there's a lot of issues around that. Some of them is that the standard procedure for research development is not being followed. So you cannot just cook up something in your lab and then you are selling it to people without going through the regulation. Getting NAFDAC approval is different from getting the approval from the WHO, the impact, like the side effect of those concussions on the life of the person who is going to... Are you telling me there's no cure for HIV? There have been cure for HIV, but you can't just give it to people.
Yeah,
if it's going to if it's going to damage their liver, if it's going to damage their kidney, then what are you placing them on these drugs?
I've personally learned a lot in programming for people living with HIV. I learned a lot from specific heroes. A lot of people, I can't mention their name, but I mean, let me even just mention one person. Dr. Morenike Obonga has been a very great hero that has taught me a lot about research ethics. You know, talking about the issue you just mentioned, if I haven't been part of this research ethics program, I wouldn't understand that treatment have to go through first phase trial, phase two trial, phase three trial,
so
before we deem it safe for people.
That's
but don't blame Dr. Abalaka. See, if you agree or disagree, just put your comment below, because I don't know what he's talking about.
No.
If I am a zoologist, what is it, veterinary doctor, I will do things the way they do it in the veterinary world. So don't mind.
Let's not talk about Dr. Abalaka.
Back to the main issue.
For me, I still want to appreciate the fact that the country has moved over the years.
Mm-hmm.
When we moved from three options, 3x5,
yeah.
Yes, we are also able to start advocating that, because when WHO set a standard that anybody with HIV who have a CD4 count that is less than 350 should be placed on treatment, and the country also adopted that. Yeah,
strategy.
I mean, it's because of limited resources, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of the strategies that can ensure that those who are in need or much in need of
being,
actually get on treatment. And then we have also moved by, to option B plus, option B, and then test and treat all, which was adopted by the former Minister of Health, Professor. What's his name? The former Minister of Health that left. Anyway, Professor Adewale, Isaac Adewale.
Yeah,
I remember,
right.
Why would
you're
I forget?
Right.
So, but right now, the big issue is that NEPUAN coordinator, Abdulkadir Ibrahim, is accusing the DG NACA and the DG management of, cutting a process to be buying, procurement of ART without following the procedure. And I think that's an accusation because there's no evidence. And then even the civil society legislative organization, the CISLAC, was also going about on the media accusing the DG NACA, accusing the NACA of not following the procurement process. But of course, you cannot mention an organization like NACA with all of the issues we have in the country. You remember the Global Forum period when there was a lot of issues that has to do with the Ministry of Health and issues around HIV funds, mismanagement and all of that. Global Fund has invested a lot of energy and resources in NACA to reshape and restructure NACA even before the new the former DG, Professor Aliu, came into office. And of course, we understand that in Nigeria, we have the principal legislative regulation that regulates the public procurement procedure in the country. That's the Public Procedure Act, our Procurement Act, PPA, in 2007. So with that, there is no agency or government ministry or parastatal of government that can do a procurement of a magnitude of 8.5 billion.
National magnitude.
Yes, without following the procedure. Without following the procedure, without following the protocol. But of course, if Nepuano sees that, had any evidence to the fact that there's a cut in the procedure or the procurement procedure was not followed and all of that, I think they should bring it forward. Because there's nobody that is above the law. They should bring it forward. Let people get this fact. You can't just go on news and say, this is the price. Who are the contractors? Give us the names. Let's see what you're talking about.
Well, it's not today we've been having audio contractors in Nigeria, but we really need to dig to the root of the investigation.
Yes.
For me, I wouldn't really go by the point of there is no evidence. I would actually say we don't have enough evidence at this point. Because remember, like I said earlier, behind every mess, there is always a message. Definitely, there is something going on for people to go as far as organizing a press conference, you know, bringing together a lot of media organization, you know, news flying up and down on Vanguard, on The Punch, you know, and also The Guardian. But, I mean, seeing these organizations quoting very old data is really, really concerning. Because when the old data are being quoted, then how do we deal with budgeting?
That's to tell you that they didn't do their research, one. And secondly, they are far away from the relevant issue or the current issue in the country as far as the national response is concerned.
So remember the days when we used to do national population size estimate?
Mm-hmm.
That we keep jamming our heads together from one civil
size of I think we've moved away from that, because right now with the national impact, survey that was conducted recently and that was concluded, I think with that, and let me tell you that the current DG of NACA was the person in charge of the NAS survey that was conducted in the country, and it did a marvelous job. And then the former DG of NACA, Professor Aliu, was also the DG of NACA then, and they worked together collaboratively in a very strong effort to ensure that we have the accurate data. And it's not like a cooked data or a data of assumption or prediction, like we have the UNAIDS telling us that there's an estimate data about people living with HIV. Now we have the accurate statistics that tell us how many number of people are living with HIV and what is the current statistics that we can rely on. And if you go to the UNAIDS website, you get all of that. If you go to NACA website, you get all of that. But my point is, the National Procurement Act in the country in 2007 had a provision for National Procurement Council. So there is no how you can do a procurement. There's a benchmark that any DG in any government agencies in the country can approve on their own. And of course, we have a board. Remember, during the past government, before President Muhammadu Buhari came into power.
Professor Muhammadu Buhari.
He's not a professor. Apology, I withdraw. Muhammadu Buhari, our president, is never, and he's not a professor.
Maybe in his lifetime, I don't know.
No, he's not a professor. He's not a professor. He's a WAEC
holder. We didn't say.
So, what actually happened is that right now, President Muhammadu Buhari in 2017 was able to, in March, February precisely, he was able to appoint a board of trustees to all of the government agencies and parastatals, including that of National Agency for the Control of AIDS. And of course, there is a particular provision, terms of reference, rules and responsibility that the board of trustees of NACA needs to do, like supervise and oversight, provide oversight function to the director general of the agency. So the director general cannot just jump all of this procedure, including that of the National Procurement Act, to go and start doing a procurement or engaging a contractor all by himself without following any of the. It's going to be a violation of the National Procurement Act and National Rule of Engagement, including the Civil Society Act.
But you know, Nigerian situation is not just enough about making acts, rules, laws, and all that. Our main issue is always about enforcement and procedures. Now, going by today's news, there's an insinuation of something going around social media that there are a number of persons or specific individuals, you know, that has intention of profiting or benefiting on the, you know, they're trying to like put some bottleneck around the procurement and provision of ARV drugs, despite all the progress that we've made over the years, making sure that we are able to deliver services to a lot of millions of people that we don't even know. We don't know their address, we don't know what state they live. Civil society actors, activists and individuals are making significant effort. Now, we are having this news, and there's an indicator in the news that people had an intention, there have been some name calling, there have been some figures, some companies and organization pledging or sending money. We cannot take this. We've actually brought the case of NSAS down. This is our next big issue we are going to deal with. Because as a citizen, we need to make sure that we look out for each other, make sure that our people are safe, in sound health. Because imagine in a country where we don't even have social security number. People cannot even depend on the solution.
So available this, this is the issue. There's a provision in the law that says that he who comes to equity must come with clean hands. So if you are advocating or you are accusing an institution, do you have a clean record yourself? Because from what we got, from the feedback that we got from some of our members in Network of People with HIV in the country, there was allegation that even the national coordinator of NEPOAN, some of the big pharmacy in the country went to meet this guy, dialogue with him, and promised to give him 15 million naira every month if he can ensure that National Agency for the Control of AIDS do a procurement through them. So it's what we're talking about is more like a blood money, right?
Because there are people dying. I can actually buy a Ferrari.
No, this is an issue of life and death.
I get it.
I think it will have been genuine if the patient community through their coordinator is coming up to challenge the process or the procurement procedure of NACA for the patient community ART, which is like a life-saving therapy. And of course, if you have a clean hand, but if the big pharma in the country are kind of trying to bribe you to ensure that you influence the procurement procedure, it's totally wrong. Because
first thing you need to do, are you considering that there might be some life at stake? Are you like re-engineering the HIV pandemic?
That is the issue.
Are you putting your country first, or are you trying to like stay another wave of a national pandemic? Are you considering the lives that will die because they are not aware, or they are not informed, or they don't even have any business to do with your own personal transaction with these people?
So now, I think we've always been having some of these issues in the country for a long time. Procurement has been a very big burden in the country. There have been a lot of corruption, there's a lot of manipulations, and people jumping the procedure, even jumping out of the National Procurement Council to get approval directly from the presidency to boycott all of those processes in order to ensure that they get money. You remember the Townes period in 2013, right? The Federal Ministry of Health was doing a direct procurement from Townex Nigerian Limited, which was producing antiviral therapy that was below standard, and they never had the WHO pre-qualification license. They don't have this approval to produce all of those things, and they were producing an ARV that have a lower efficacy and that can have a long time side effect on the life of the person.
And then when people develop resistance, it's saying
so something. Then I think when we did a lot of writing, procedure consultations, dialogue, all those things need a work for Nigeria. And that's why, you know, all these answers, when people were saying, let's write, you write petition, you go tire, because your petition is going to end on the table of an individual who is a criminal himself, who is highly corrupt, and who is like the foundation or the genesis and alpha and omega of the problems you are petitioning about. So
the first thing they will tell you is that this is what they're speaking.
Yes. So because of that, what Nigeria understand, the language that our government understand better in terms of change is when people go online to, when people come out to protest. So the patient community, I can remember in South Africa during the international conference on AIDS, we're able to mobilize aliens from around the world, and there was movement and campaign from International Treatment Preparedness Coalition and Treatment Act Activist Movement, and we're able to put to shame the officers of government to say that you cannot continue the procurement of a locally manufactured ARV that is below the universal standard and that doesn't have the WHO pre-qualification license, giving it to PNHIV in the public health institution in the country, and you are saying to hell with you, take it or leave it. And those ARV like shock.
I mean, it doesn't matter where it comes from, whether local or international, as long as it meets the global regulation, like the basic standard, you know, because we are also not trying to like kill off opportunity for local pharmaceutical company. But whoever or whichever organization or company that's interested in providing support, there's a global standard that needs to be followed, and we always need to adhere to this whole process. Concerning this allegation, we have a very few information at our fingertips, but we really just we do depend on a lot of our viewers at this point, people from State Saka, NEPWAN, community members, because sometimes some people actually will be the first to have the real information and they can share with
so, we're going to use this medium to advocate to people, members from Association of Positive Living with HIV, Association of Women Living with HIV, Network of Religious Leaders Living with
civil
HIV,
society
civil society organization, including civil society organization in the country. All of these people need to come up with information if they have any, so we can have another episode to give out more information, and then people can contribute. You can put in your contribution. You can share your information about any of those things that you have around this issue. But of course, what I'm going to say is that there is no how that the government of Nigeria or any agency in the country or ministry can jump the public procurement act.
It's not done.
If you do that, it's an offense. It is contrary to civil service regulation. Mm-hmm. And of course, if you have more evidence, I know there are a lot of petitions that have been flying around, even to National Human Rights Committee in the National Assembly. In the National Assembly, in the Senate, and in the House of Rep. And of course, they've also written to EFCC and all of that. But you can't just write on the sake of writing. There should be evidence. You know, this procurement, evidence of these things. And if you have more, bring it up. We're going to do this together, because it's a fight for the people in HIV. And you talked about, it doesn't matter where the drugs come from. It matters, because it's about the life of an individual. You won't give me a drug to say this drug...
But I'm more concerned about quality and standard. If it's produced in my bedroom or Awolowo Road or Ikoyi, let us grow local company of international standard, or bring the international pharmaceutical agency to the country and produce and support. Africa is so bad and transmission is going on every single day.
Let me explain to you. I'm also a strong advocate of local production, because I know that if we have the capacity to produce ARV, of course, Nigeria or any other country in West Africa, you know, we have about 25% contribution to the pandemic in the country, in Africa as a whole. And of course,
it's not an epidemic, because it's endemic.
Yes. If we have a local manufacturing company, of course, there's going to be a lot of benefit. Apart from, we are going to be reducing the cost of procurement, because we're not going to be exchanging our local currency to dollars to do a procurement. And of course, the GDP is...
Sometimes they exchange to five.
It's going to contribute... It's going to contribute to the GDP of the country. It's going to create employment within the country, within the West Africa. It's also going to do a lot of, including the cost reduction in price. But the standard needs to be met. The regulation needs to be met. And WHO pre-qualification, because no pharmaceutical company in the world... Let me explain.
WHO says it cannot produce in Nigeria.
No. WHO did not say that. Let's not misquote what the law says. There is a standard. Right, any life-saving therapy, including cancer treatment, including HIV, tuberculosis, you cannot produce any of this medication without meeting a specific international standard. And that regulation is set. There's nothing that can go below. So you cannot give a pure water producing company or a company that is producing paracetamol. No, to start producing ARV. It's not granite or something. So what we are saying is that it is not NAFDAC that will give approval to a local manufacturing company in Nigeria to start producing ARV. Never. It is not Ministry of Health. It has to be the international body that regulates those production, because it's a life-saving therapy.
Going forward, we need to appreciate the fact that we've made some progress. Back in the days of getting to zero, which almost is synonymous to when we had 10,000 people on treatment and more and more.
Yes.
So the era where we were actually advocating for nobody is being left behind. Campaign.
That's the test and treat all.
Yeah. And at this point, we are like at the point of target 1990, if I'm still correct.
Yes. But Nigeria is still far away from achieving that.
Well, we are making progress. We don't want to say all this without acknowledging the significant effort of all of us. We know both people who are just medical doctors, students, social workers, researchers, monitoring and evaluation officers, account personnel, volunteers on the field, people living with HIV and AIDS, and people who are not living with HIV and AIDS that are contributing to this national HIV response. We really salute you, we celebrate you, we acknowledge your support, and we are appreciative of what we've done so far. But the point where we are right now is a critical juncture whereby we need to actually dig out and investigate and research into what's going on. Otherwise, we are just going to slide back into the previous situation. Everything's just going to go like down the drain.
So I think more effort needs to be put in this particular investigation, because one of the civic responsibility of a patient movement or civil society organization in any country is to do budget tracking. Okay. So you follow the money. So if a particular budget is being released or budgeted for a particular intervention or a cost in the country, we need a civil society organization that can be able to track, where is this money going? How much was released? And how is this money spent? There should be accountability, transparency.
How are procurements made?
Yes. And all of this procedure, we need to challenge, because it is not the government themselves that is going to be accounting for themselves. Mm-hmm. The community needs to demand that there is accountability, mm-hmm. and we need to champion the cause on behalf of the people. Mm-hmm. So I think what CISLA and NEPWAN or other civil society organizations are doing, if it is in a good intention, right?
We're
if it is
it.
With a good intention,
we'll see.
It's very good. Mm-hmm. And they need not, if you want to come to FPT, come with clean hands. Don't have a bribery allegation as well from big pharma in the country, and you want to boycott the process to benefit you as an individual. It is criminal.
So is it like big pharmaceutical companies are making propositions to bribe certain people so that they can be the sole distributor?
Of course, these guys have their way every time in the country. You know, when I was in Nigeria, there was a time we were doing this self-test kit.
Stop sounding like I just came back.
No, I didn't just say that. What I'm saying is, back in Nigeria, you know, there was a time where the Ministry of Health launched self-test kit for HIV. Mm-hmm. And then we have these pharmaceutical companies who are coming behind to romance the network, the patient network, to say, oh, you know what, we can support you, we can give you this and that. And all they want is that they want you to be able to influence the process so that the Ministry of Health can endorse their products. And of course, there are a lot of pharmaceutical companies that are producing these kits. So it has to be a competitive bidding. That's what is being established in the program.
I was going to say that was marketing at first, but then you actually made an emphasis to competition. We need positive competition. We need people to be able to bid and treat us like we want coming to the negotiation
table. It's going to be an open bidding process. You can't boycott to influence a procurement process,
whether it's
because
good or not.
You want to bribe someone so that you cannot be at edge above other competitors in the country. For me, I am not going to be part of that, and I've never done that. And for me, I think it has to be an open process. And the people in the Ministry of Health, because I shouldn't be part of the procurement process. I should be the one monitoring the process, exactly. Challenging the government to say, did you follow what your policy says? Mm-hmm. And of course,
ensuring that state SACA actually follow national regulations.
Yes, including the federal, the National Agency for the Control of it. For me, and there's another accusation, the network of people with HIV was saying that the procurement of ART and the management of ART should be given to NASCAP. All of that is not going to happen, because NACA has a long history, over two decades, history of managing people living with HIV, supervising, coordinating, and then doing all of those responsibilities. So, apart from what is specified in the NACA Act, I think there's a lot for us as an institution and as patient community or civil society movement to look beyond individual interests when you are advocating for issues.
How do they even get to that? Who is NASCAP?
NASCAP, of course.
Where does she live?
That's the national.
It's like, I don't even know where she lives.
What do you mean? That's
like, is that a name of a school?
That's the national control.
It's the name of a three.
It's a national, national STI control, STI and HIV infection control, whatever agency.
Okay.
It's like
okay.
A person that was. They can never be a competitor to NACA, because NACA's role and responsibility is well defined. Yes, it's well defined in NACA Act, and I don't think there should be a right.
I think the Board of Trustees should be responsible for managing.
Even NEPWAN National Coordinator is a member of the Board of Trustees of NACA.
So you should voice out.
I mean, at that level, you are supposed to be like a board of trustee. You are supposed to be a brand ambassador for that organization. Mm-hmm. You are supposed to be the voice. Mm-hmm. And then, if anything is going wrong, we should ask you. We should hold you accountable because you are there. So, internally, I think NEPA National Coordinator needs to utilize the internal mechanism of communication, ensuring that things, you don't go to blow your trumpet. You are living in a house, in a glass house, and you are throwing stone. You break the whole house down.
Okay, the actual figure that is on the internet right now says the drug cost was actually around $7.
Mm-hmm.
And there is an intention to do, is it Ajoje they used to call it, or how do they call it? So that the drug will go to like about $13 or maybe even $15 per head. So this cost, this price hike is going to come out from, we don't know whichever ministry or federal government prosecutor is coming from. But we know that people in the country have actually been going through a lot with the psychological effect of COVID-19. We don't want access to treatment for people that are actually living with HIV to now be the problem. Because, you know, looking at the 3 A's or the 5 A's of, you know, service provision, we always think about availability, affordability and accessibility. So affordability at this point is really the issue of concern. Okay. Otherwise, a lot of
I think the big A there is not only about accessibility, affordability and availability of those drugs. Accountability is also the big picture. And for a long time in the country, procurement have been the issue. That's where the vampire of corruption lies, even within the Ministry of Health and every other agencies in the country. So I feel that more organization need to come on, and because we have the National Freedom of Information Act, it's good for any other organization that wants to do budget tracking at this time to go to NACA. You can actually request for this procurement document, and so when you are speaking or you are asked, yes, there should be evidence. Bring document, let's see what this document says. When you say the price for the procurement is $7, where is the evidence? Who gave you that price?
Exactly.
And if you say it's they want to buy it at $13, what evidence do you have?
Mm-hmm.
So I think we should move to another level, not just coming online, calling press people, and then giving them money. And journalists in Nigeria,
they like
you call
money,
them, you don't give them money. Everybody likes whatever you want them to write.
From the hotel room, they will write something.
So we are still going to continue on this issue because there's going to be more calls, even from the patient community, from NACA, from Ministry of Health. And when we get more information, more details, we are still going to come online and we're going to do more discussion around this.
So let's be thinking proactively. It's not all about tea break and lunch.
Yes.
Know, all this stuff that we used to get. We need to take a proactive step as a country, as a group of people, and make sure that, you know, we promote and support a safe and sound and healthy country and healthy community.
And finally, we're going to be recommending to Nigerian government that for us to end the drama of HIV response in the country, it will be cost effective when we can support any local manufacturing company to meet the WHO pre-qualification license, and let's start local production of ARV. Nigeria has one of the largest consumer of ARV in Africa, aside from South Africa. So South Africa had about 7 million people in HIV. With 1.9 million, that's a huge number. And within the West African region, we can actually be a hub to supply commodities if our manufacturing companies have the capacity and they meet the requirements to do all of this production.
Okay, thank you very much for watching. We'll talk to you later. Please put down your comments, observation, send us inbox, you know.
Thank you.
Stay in touch. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Again.
What's happening? It's not ending. Oh my God.
To end.
Oh my God.